administrator of maintenance and I work in the UK. It's an honor for me to be here today for the first time at the international stage, presenting what I have been working on over the past 2.5 years, something that I'm really passionate about. I'm calling this anterior non-episiotomy forceps delivery or ANEF. And this is a number of maneuvers during the normal episiotomy, sorry, during the normal forceps delivery that we all perform. A number of maneuvers that actually can adjust our technique in a way that we can minimize obstetric anal sphincter injuries, also known as OASIS. Now, it is widely accepted that the instrumental delivery is linked to an increased risk of obstetric anal sphincter injuries. However, there is no indication that routine episiotomy during these instrumental deliveries reduces the risk of OASIS. In the most recent guidance that the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists produced, that was in June this year, they say that as clinicians, we should be explaining to women that the evidence for the protective role of episiotomy is conflicting. So, OASIS rates with both routine and restrictive episiotomy are high. They have been quoted as 8.1% with routine and 10.9% with restrictive episiotomy. So, the main objective when I started looking into this was to try and reduce these rates of OASIS. So I started by thinking that this discrepancy in the protective role of episiotomy, it made me start questioning my practice. If it doesn't work, then why do I perform episiotomy? If I don't perform episiotomy, then what do I have to offer instead? Could perhaps by adjusting my technique during the instrumental delivery offer some protection against perineal trauma? So despite popular belief among my colleagues that I stopped performing episiotomy because I was too lazy to repair it, it wasn't because of that I started thinking about what could I do to protect the woman. I was quite lucky at that point to move to a unit of low-risk women, a unit where we would expect most of them to deliver normally. So the idea was quite simple, really. I was thinking that nature, whatever nature does it to try and protect itself. So we see here a chameleon, how it adjusts its colors to the environment. So I was thinking, what does the baby try to do to protect its mother against OASIS? And we see that as the baby is emerging, apart from the overlapping of the fetal skull bones, the neck of the baby extends acutely anteriorly. So it takes the pressure away from the perineum and up towards the upper part of the vagina. So my concept was that if I was trying to mimic my forceps delivery as close to a natural birth as possible, in theory at least, the risk of OASIS would be reduced.
So the initial application and safety checks are as per traditional method. Initial pull is again as per method that we know, which is with the right hand pulling and the left hand pressing downwards. So the first pull is as per traditional method. Now when the head is coming, it is essential that we ask the assistant to lower the bed all the way down. So the bed all the way down, please. And then we try to follow with the forceps the natural path of fetal head delivery, which is anteriorly. There's no need to apply any rotation in the perineum. It goes by delivering the head upwards in a controlled manner. We take most of the pressure and the strain in the upper part of the vagina. And at this stage, we ask mom to pant, and while she's panting gently, we deliver the head upwards.
Let me add that in real life, you need to come much closer to the patient than that so you have a better control of the forceps. This is my collected data over the past 2.5 years in 4 different units. This number 117 is 117 consecutive Neville Barnes forceps deliveries in primates with the babies coming OA or coming OP turned to OA, and these were all delivered without episiotomy. So there were only four cases of OASIS, that's a 3.4%. So this 3.4% of OASIS in 117 primipari women without episiotomy is quite encouraging. As we saw, the corresponding rates of OASIS in routine and restricted by episiotomy are 8.1 and 10.9% respectively. These four cases of OASIS out of the 117 women, they were secondary to forceful, expulsive maternal effort. And this is why you need the cooperation of the woman. You need to reassure her. You need to be in control. Let her know that there is a point where she will stop. She will have to stop pushing and start panting instead. But also, you have to be in control of your forceps. You need to be aware that at any point, despite her best efforts, she might feel an overwhelming urge to push. There were no adverse fetal outcomes. All babies had outcomes of 10 at 5 minutes. Now, if you don't cut, there's no unnecessary bleeding. If you don't cut an episiotomy, so only 11 out of those 117 women had a PPH of more than 1,000. That's a 9.4%, when the aim should be less than 33% according to the hospital episode statistics of the NHS. As our colleague from Canada said, enhanced recovery pathways are becoming increasingly part of our obstetric and gynecological surgery. This is a way of minimizing impact during operative procedures while improving care. Adjusting our technique can reduce the rate of OASIS without compromising the fetus. It is further associated with improved maternal recovery as we avoid episiotomy and we minimize the blood loss. This is introducing the anterior non-episiotomy forceps, ANEF. ANEF also in Greek means without, as in without episiotomy. For some reason, the midwives tend to call it natural forceps. But I feel that this could potentially be part of this enhanced recovery pathways. There are no conflicts of interest to declare. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Stelias. The paper is open for questions. Yes.
Thank you for your presentation. I'm just wondering if you had any statistics on any other obstetric trauma that you may have seen. Were there higher rates of vaginal lacerations, other cervical lacerations?
Yeah, I prepared some extra slides because I was expecting questions like that. So these were the primates. You can see that we get 24% of intact perineum, and that's in the primate. We have 26% of first degree tests, 22nd degree of what I call small second degree, which means that the muscle is just exposed. Less than 20% of your average second degree there. What I call extensive second degree, it means that apart from the usual second degree, they had some additional vaginal wall tears, and that's the 3rd degree and 1/4 degree there. So overall, you can see how this way of delivering babies can be protected to the mom.
Thank you.
I'm certainly going to ask another question. Anita Harding from Canada. What is your typical routine, I guess, with removal of the forceps? Do you remove the forceps when the baby's head starts to crown, or do you actually pull the baby's head through the birth canal until the head is completely out? Because I think that has a huge impact.
That's
as well.
A very good question. I know that in the US, and I assume in Canada, practice is that you guys remove the forceps as the head is crowning, and then you protect it by you. In the UK, we hold on to the forceps up until the end. So it's only once the head is out that the forceps are removed. By doing this, also you get a very good control of slow, gentle delivery of the head.
It seems interesting that you're going from normal delivery to forceps assisted outlet delivery. Now, that's the first comment that I'm making. Is it a way of reintroducing forceps into the delivery in the second stage? The second question would be, that would one be able to use a ventus or a kiwi or something in the same mechanism as their sensitivities with the use of forceps and ventus in certain parts of the world? Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a very good question. I will start with your second point about kiwi, and it can be done with kiwi. I have done it with kiwi. However, again, you don't get as good control as you do with forceps, because it is essential. The mother feels a strong urge to push. It is essential that you hold back, that you are having control. With kiwi, unfortunately, you don't. Once you remove the kiwi, anything can happen. So it can happen, it can be done with kiwi, but you have to be acutely aware that once at least you remove your kiwi, you have to, with your hands, protect the head so that she doesn't just push. Now, with regards to your first part of the question about reintroducing, I know that there is a trend towards trainees to try and avoid forceps and go for cesarean section on the second stage with whatever this implicates. However, it is safe. Forceps are safe, and it has been documented as a safe way of delivering babies. And I think with us normalizing forceps, we can reintroduce forceps back into routine practice.
Thank you, Dr. Stelios. I think we had a nice question answer. And we switch over to the next one. And next colleague.